ATR is basically a communication between the aircraft and the tower, and the procedures that you have to follow, the phraseologies that you have to follow during the RTR, like when you are communicating with one person to the another from the aircraft to the tower, or from the tower to the aircraft, or between two aircrafts. Now, how can we communicate? What are the procedures? So whenever we are communicating, there should be some phraseologies used so that we can be in a very compressed statement, and it could be understandable by everyone whenever you are flying. So taking an example for that, basic format to how to communicate with the person can be started with a normal conversation, saying that who you are calling. That can be the tower or the aircraft, saying that Delhi Tower. So that is my pronunciation to the communication to whom I am calling that call. Who you are, that means myself. I am the aircraft. So what is the aircraft registration? So that would be the registration of the aircraft. Where are you? Where are you? That would be known as the position. So whenever we are conducting a flight, whenever we communicate, we need to give an information to the ground stations of the position. So position can be included with the height of the aircraft, the time, and the position where you are on any of the mandatory reporting point or somewhere. So the position report can be DOPIT 1100 flight level 320. So that would be the position of the aircraft. Now, what do you want? And if I'm giving a call, it would be for some reason. I can ask for the approach, I can ask for the deviation, I can ask for any other such incidents that happen in the aircraft so that I can report it, which is the emergency report if I need to give. So this would be the basic format, how we communicate with the ground station if I'm flying an aircraft. Now, if I'll take an example of, if I'm taking an example, saying that if I'm standing on a stand of the parking bay in the apron area and I need to start my engine. So what would be the procedures? What would be the startup call that you'll be giving to the tower that so that they can give you a permission? Now, the startup call would require many things that should be included in that, saying that where are you, whom you are calling, what position you are, and what do you want. So I would be reading a startup call. I'll explain you what is the startup call and what are the requirements during the startup call. Now, whenever if I'm asking a startup permission or the pushback permission, there should be many things, including the asking for pushback. The security check should be carried out, saying that all the passengers has been crossed the security check, and all the passengers on the board, all the cabin crews and the flight crews or the cockpit crews has been passed through a security check, and the airport has done that. So this is the first condition to ask for the security check. And if whenever in the flight you get to know that some sort of passengers or the cockpit crew has not undergone any security check, then you would not be able to give a permission to start the engines. Then the second thing, the requirement of the second thing is that the step ladders or the aero bridge should be disconnected from the aircraft whenever we are asking for the startup call or the pushback call. This is the reason why we need to do it, because if you ask for the startup call and if you are connected with the aero bridge, then there are chances that it would get collapsed or it would damage the aircraft. So this is also the most important, that you are aware that the aero bridge or the aerobridge or the step ladder has been disconnected so that you can start the engines and you would be allowed to go for the pushback or whatever it is. Then the second and the last most important is the all doors should be closed of the aircraft. Now, why this is also important? If the door is open, you would not be able to start the engines because there would be a lot of inconvenience to the passengers. So this is also one condition. So whenever this all three conditions are fulfilled, then only you would be able to ask for the startup call. And whenever you are asking for the startup call, the controller whom you are calling, saying that to the tower if you are calling, so they should be also knowing that you have done this all checks. So, and we have to provide through the communication process. So what step and what format you would be doing, and telling to them in a very basic format, so that they would be able to understand it very nicely, and it would be communicable with both of the pilot and the tower controller. So the basic format, whenever we ask for the startup call, shall be saying that whom you are calling, that would be the tower. who you are. That would be myself saying that the aircraft, which is 6E120 or Victor Tango Alpha Charlie uniform, what is the registration of the aircraft? That would be your name. Then the frequency on which you are communicating. Then the fourth is the position. Position is basically where you are at the apron. I am at apron stand 2, position parking bay stand 2, stand 1. Whatever the parking bay number you are standing and park the aircraft, you will tell your position with respect to them. And then you will inform that the security check has been carried out. Person on board is like 120 or 180 with the specific of the passengers on the board. Time, what is the actual time, current time, so that they can match with the communication time, so that they don't have any difference, and the clearance should be matched with the clearance that has been given, so that both are on the same time scale. Duration of the flight. Now, we need to give a duration of the flight, saying that if after departure, if I am not communicable with them, so they should be knowing the duration of the flight, so they can take actions accordingly in the future if there is something wrong with the flight. So duration of the flight would be like 2 hours for the 3 hours. So you'd be saying that 0400 or 0200. Then request startup or pushback. So this would be the basic format. I'll give you an example saying that how the startup call should be with the example of a question. So in the examination, you would maybe ask with a question saying that you are ready to start in the engine, departure aerodrome Jodhpur, aircraft ATR 6E120, which is the registration of the aircraft, destination is Jaipur, time is 0100, and take action. So in this question, this would be the question asked in the examination. So this is the basic format or the question how they can ask. So over here, they have informed you all the things that are required in the basic format that I have been made over here for you all. So whom you are calling, that would be what? The Jodhpur Tower, right? The second thing is that who you are. I am the ATR 6E120. My destination is Jaipur. Time they have given, and take action. Now the fourth information that they have not provided to us is the parking bay. So whenever something is such that, so you can put anything which is acknowledgeable to them and which is very understandable, that the parking bay would be obviously stand 1 or stand 2. So I'll make a format regarding this and I'll explain you how the call would be. Saying that Jodhpur Tower, I fly 120 on decimal 118 decimal 3, stand 2, security check carried out, person on board 70, request startup, time 0115. Now, why I have given a time which is greater than 0100? Because the time is that when you decided to give a startup call, and whenever you are having a conversation with that, at the same time, you would not be able to start the engines unless and until you don't get the clearance. So I need a startup at 0115. So this is the basic format how you would be giving a call. I will just once again repeat and get it into a flow so that you can be able to understand it in more better. Jodhpur Tower, I fly 120 on frequency 118.3, stand 2, security check carried out, person on board 270, request startup, time 0115. So this would be the basic format and the how the examiners would give you the marks on the basis of this. Now, every question or the whatever the answer you are giving, there would be a bifurcation of the marks given to the examination, to the person who is giving the examination. Now, each question in the RTR syllabus, there would be 5 questions and each question would be conducted of 20 marks. Now, this question that they have been asked, that would be conducted for the 10 marks. So, how they would give you the marks on the basis of that? So, if I am on the basis of this, so if I include everything which is in this format, I would get a 10 marks over here. Now, how I would be giving, if whom you're calling, the station whom you're calling is the correct, then you will get 2 marks. Who you are, if that is correct, which is given in the information, that is the ATRs and it is 6E. So I fly 120. If that is correct, you would be getting 2 marks. So on the basis of that, whatever things have been provided in the question paper and the question, and if you get to know what it is, and whenever you start giving a call, if everything is correct, you'd be able to score 10 marks in the examination for this question. So in this manner, this would be the startup call or the pushback call. Now, understanding it in more further, whenever we give a startup call, there are many things which have been twisted in the questions. They may be asked to ask for the priority for the startup call, because whenever we are on a very busy airport, you don't get a startup call very fast. Now, right now, in the last question, they have told me that, saying that they ask the startup call at 10100. I have asked for time, which is 0115. Now, they would not tell me that you would be getting a startup call. I have requested this. Now, Tower would say startup at 0130. But now, you need some priority to start the engines so that you can reach the destination on time. So now, whenever you need such things, then you can ask for the priority message. Now, what is the priority message and why we need to give priority, and what all reasons would be considered so that you can get a priority in the departure or the startup call, whatever it is. So that can happen only when the aircraft is carrying some emergency things which are required to the destination, and there should be no acceptable delay in that. So that at that moment, you can ask for the priority. Now, what all reasons would be there where the tower controller would accept the priority of your request, and they can give you an expedite startup or the taxi or what departure to the destination. So they can be like human organ on board. If there is a rescue flight, if you are conducting a rescue flight, then they can give you a priority. If there is a VIP on your board, then they can give you a priority. If the aircraft is conducted as an air ambulance, then they can give you a priority. Then if the aircraft is flying for the cyclonic storm or victims like floods during the flood and the cyclones, then they can give you a priority. Or humanitarian flight, any of the rescue flight or the VIP flight where the flight would not accept any of the delay to reach the destination and for the safety of the flight and for the passengers, then only the tower controller can give you a priority. Now, asking for the priority, there are many conditions. So this would be the conditions. Now, where this information would be given on the question paper. So they can give a question saying that you are at Jodhpur and your flight is for the rescue flight for the floods in the Kolkata. This information would be given in a very nice statement. So you would be able to understand and you would be able to know. So you have to phrase an answer with the help of this. So the call for the priority message can be like, Jodhpur Tower, I fly 120, frequency 118.3, stand 2, security check carried out, POB 70. This is a rescue flight for the flood victims. Request priority startup at 0115. Now, this would emphasize the question, and you have asked for the priority and you have told the reason also to the tower controller. So in this way, you can frame your questions in the respective to the incident or whatever is the information is given in the question paper, and you can build up a question in that manner. Now, I will explain you more questions on the basis of that, how all startup calls have been twisted in the examination, so that you can be able to understand it and you can frame that in a many different manners. Now, in the first thing, whenever we ask for the startup call, I told you that the security check for all the passengers shall be conducted. Now, if any passenger is not gone through any security check and you get to know when they are aboard the aircraft, you'd not be able to ask for the startup call, and you are not able to go for the departure to the destination. If you are conducting a flight, you'd not be able to conduct that. So whenever such thing comes, then what actions you will be taking? Now the question has been framed in such a manner that you are ready to start the engines, but there is a lapse in security check, take actions. Now the question says that every call has been accepted from your side and you are the pilot, you are flying the aircraft, so actions would be taken from your side. But during the examination, what actions you will be taking? Unless and until you don't know what are the requirements, you'd not be able to know what are the actions taken in this condition. So now, as I told you, for the startup call, security check for all the passengers shall be conducted. So what it is like, so whenever this question such arise, then what you'll be doing? So Jodhpur Tower, I fly 120, frequency 118.3, will disembark the passengers for the security check, request vehicle or request back to the apron if you have started taxiing and you get to know. So if this question is saying that you are taxiing and you get to know that one of the passenger is not crossed the security check, take actions immediately. So you'll be asking to the tower controller saying that Jodhpur Tower, I fly 120 on frequency 118.3, taxiing on alpha, taxi back to apron due to one of the passenger has not crossed the security check and we need to disembark the passenger. So this way you would be able to frame the question and you would be able to give to the tower controller so that they can take actions accordingly, whatever have you been asked, right? So this is the thing. Now there are many things in the examination that can be asked, and saying that what all you'd be getting to know, what all you need to learn in the RTR is that if you are conducting a flight from one point to the another, what all incidents would be happening in a normal flight, that all incidents you'd be getting in the examination from the startup to the landing purpose, all the questions you'd be asked in the examination, saying that if you have been started from one point to another, the first call that you'd be conducting with the tower controller is the startup call, then you'll ask for the taxi, then you'll ask for the ATC clearance. ATC clearance is basically the clearance that has been given to the pilot or the flight. After the departure, what all actions you'll be taking so that you can get on the route to the destination. So up till that, whatever information has been given, so the ATC clearance can be given such that I fly 120, you can depart from runway 27. After departure, you can climb straight at 2000 feet, then turn right on a radial of 0100, climb till 5000 feet, and then report. So this would be the ATC clearance, that is the from the takeoff to the first segment where you are flying. So they can give you a guidance to the flight to conduct from one place to another. Then after the ATC clearance, you'd be asking for such that climb to your flight plan, flight level. So whatever you have been filled up flight level, saying that I have filed a flight level of 310, and you'd be asking for the climb ahead to flight level 310. Then whenever we are on the cruise, the incidents can be coming, saying that weather deviation call is there, if there is a RVSM failure. So we'll be able to understand all the incidents that are happening in the examination or in the actual flight. And we'll be able to understand all the format basis on that with the respective that we have learned of the startup call in the in this lecture. Like, so now I will give you one example of weather deviation call. If you are conducting a flight, and if you are required or you have been asked in the question to deviate due to weather, then what are conditions that can be coming in this weather deviation? So weather deviation can be in the many manners, saying that weather deviation when ATC is in contact and ATS route is available, then what actions you will be taking whenever this condition is happening. But if there is no ATC in contact and you have a ATS route available, then what you will be doing? If you are not able to contact with the tower or the ATC controller on the ground station, then what action you'll be taking? Because this is a mandatory thing, you cannot go into the weather. So what you would be doing when such condition arise? So there is a format, there is a rules and regulation applied to these calls so that you can deviate accordingly, and you can saying that you can give a answer without any ATC and communicate with the other aircraft so that they are aware that where your position is, and you can conduct a flight with a normal, with no emergencies happening on it or no such incidents happening. So that what are the rules and regulations in that, we'll be able to understand. So whenever weather deviation call is required, when a deviation is required, there would be four conditions happening, and that would be weather deviation when ATC is in contact and ATS route is available. The other condition can be weather deviation when ATC is in contact and no ATS route is available, then what you'll be doing? Weather deviation when no ATS route available and ATC is in contact. Weather deviation when not in contact with ATC and no ATS route available. So these are the four conditions that can happen, or they've been asked in the examination to the student, so that they can frame the question and take the actions accordingly with the respective the question paper. So I'll give you an example saying that weather deviation call format when ATC is in contact and ATS route available. Now, what they are trying to tell me over here is that you are flying, saying that you are flying from one point to the another. Your cruising is like Ebani Alpha 471. This is the route of the aircraft. Okay. Now, if there is a weather over here and there is one route, which is Alpha 432, saying that this is one waypoint and Alpha 432 north. This is the route that has been given and there is a weather on your ahead. You are over here. You need to decide now what you need to do. You are in the coordination with the ATC. What the basic thing you would be doing, you'd not be able to go from this place, this route. You'd not be able to go from Alpha 471. So you need to conduct a flight to avoid this weather. So what you'll be doing in a simple language, you will divert your flight from Alpha 432 south to this waypoint, saying that this is the Songhad. And then from Songhad, you will go on Alpha 43 north to this waypoint. So this is the basic format that you'll be doing, a basic procedure that you'll be doing so that you can avoid this weather. So now how to frame this so that it is very easier to understandable to the tower controller who is on the ground station and he can give you a clearance accordingly. So our point is to how to express what I need to do. So this is the format that you will be doing, saying that whom you are calling, is this ground station, who you are, position, time and flight level. That is the position of your aircraft, saying that I am at Ebani 0100, flight level 320. That would be the position of yours. Will alter course from present position to avoid weather. Will reroute via. Now, will reroute via means like I was about to reroute from the downwards with the Alpha 431 to Songhad and from Alpha 43 north to the way other. So that would be my reroute thing. So how I'm gonna reroute? So I will say in this manner. Now then, will rejoin, estimate of route's waypoint. Now whatever deviation has been taken, you need to provide the estimate of that waypoints also, because you are deviating your flight. So they need to know that what time you are arriving at that waypoint so that they can give you a separation regarding that only. So that's why we need to ask permission from the ground station. Estimate of the route points has been given, then total estimated elapsed time. Now the deviation that you are conducting, that deviation also increase your time duration to reach the destination. So what is the total estimated elapsed time of your aircraft because of deviation? So you need to give that the total estimated elapsed time would be 0 to 00 hours. So that would be increased now. That can happen to 0 to 15 minutes has can increase. Endurance of the aircraft, you need to give the endurance, total endurance of the aircraft with respect to the fuel present on board, right? Then the aircraft speed test, request permission. So how you would be framing this question on the basis of this format that I'll let you know now. Then one question is that example for weather deviation when ATC in contact and no ATS route available. If such thing is happening, then what will be happening? So Delhi control, Victor Tango Alpha Charlie uniform, position Ebani 1100, flight level 310. Will alter course from present position due weather, will reroute via Bravo 209, Osram, Whiskey 20 and rejoin at Vilop, estimate Songhad 1130, estimate Osram 1120, next waypoint which is Vilop 1130, revised ETA, Bravo, 1230, TEET which is the total estimated elapsed time 0200, endurance 0400, test 300 knots, request permission. So this is basically what is this format. I have just applied and took the information from the question paper. I have put it on this format and I have read the question. So whenever you have been asked such question on the basis of weather deviation, you would be using this format. So the students just need to understand what this format is and how they need to put all the information which are given in the question paper, and you have to just pick the highlighted things which are required for you in the respective to this format, and you have to pick that information and just you need to put it on the format so that the answer that you have been framed is very good and it is presentable and it is with the respective to the regulation that how the RT call should be whenever there is a weather deviation call required. So basically you have not done anything over here, just you have told them that I'm gonna reroute my flight and the reroute flight would estimate this, this things would be estimating with the time respective and what your changes are there in your flight plan with respective to the deviation. So that actions you had been taken. Now, so this is what the thing is there. Can you hear everyone, right, sir?
Yeah, Siddha, yeah, we can hear. Siddha, I think whatever sessions, like whatever examples we have taken, it's sufficient. Is there anything that you are going to cover new stuff or because we feel that it's pretty good, whatever examples we have taken.
So,
is there any like, addition that you're planning to cover?
No, the addition is there is nothing new. I am just explaining you what all different calls would be there in the aviation, means like in the weather deviation. So, I'm going to explain you with respect to this all formats only, sir.
No, not required because this is just an introductory. So, Captain, can I request you to stop recording now, please?